Hi, I'm Dawn Corbett, the NIH Inclusion Policy Officer in the Office of Extramural Research. And today I want to talk to you about considering inclusion in NIH grant applications and contract proposals. Our goals for this session are to learn how NIH inclusion policies are addressed when applying for or proposing NIH clinical research, to understand how peer review evaluates plans for inclusion, and to recognize requirements for reporting and monitoring inclusion in clinical research. As a reminder, we have several policies related to inclusion in clinical research at NIH. Our policy on the inclusion of women and minorities states that all NIH-funded or supported clinical research is mandated by law. And there are additional requirements for NIH-defined phase 3 clinical trials to consider whether the study can be expected to identify potential differences by sex or gender, race, or ethnicity. NIH policy also requires recipients include individuals across the lifespan when conducting clinical research, unless there is a scientific or ethical reason for their exclusion. And the goal of all these policies is to ensure that individuals are included in clinical research in a manner appropriate to the scientific question under study. So what's required for inclusion when applying for NIH funding? Well, if you're applying for NIH funding, you'll need to include plans for the inclusion of women and minorities. And if you're proposing an NIH-defined phase 3 clinical trial, you'll also need to address plans for valid analyses of differences in effect by sex or gender, race, and ethnicity. In addition, you'll need to provide an inclusion enrollment report. This is a table that provides data on sex or gender, race, and ethnicity of the sample. And you may be providing either planned or cumulative enrollment, depending on the study design. And you'll also need to include plans for inclusion of individuals across the lifespan and provide us age limits, if applicable, and a justification for any age limits in your research. As I mentioned on the previous slide, you'll submit an inclusion enrollment report with your application. The inclusion enrollment report includes a table with the sex or gender, race and ethnicity of each participant in your research, either planned or actual, depending on whether you have enrolled your participants yet. And it also includes a number of data attributes which you'll provide. For example, are you using an existing data set? And is the population foreign or domestic? If you are recruiting individuals both within the US and outside the US, you'll need to provide that information on separate forms. Once you submit an application to NIH, your application will undergo peer review, and each reviewer will assess the inclusion plans. Your inclusion plans that you provide should explain the population that you plan to include in your research, as well as any plans for outreach to those groups. Peer review will assess this and determine an overall rating of acceptable or unacceptable. And projects that are considered to be unacceptable may not be funded until any concerns are resolved. So you can see on the right an example of what you may see on your summary statement if you're doing NIH-funded research. Your summary statement will include codes for gender, minority, and children. And the code will indicate whether reviewers found the population that you proposed to be acceptable or unacceptable. In the example provided, you can see that the gender and minority populations were considered to be acceptable, but the population based on age was considered to be unacceptable. In this case, this study could not be funded until any concerns regarding the age of participants are resolved. There are some common concerns that come up in peer review of inclusion. First, you may have inadequate information describing the sex or gender, race, ethnicity, or age of the sample. This information may be missing altogether, or you may not provide enough information for peer review to determine whether your plan is acceptable. For example, just saying we will not exclude any groups is generally not considered to be enough information for peer review to make that determination. You may have inadequate justification for the proposed sample. So the sex or gender, the race, the ethnicity, or the age breakdown may not be appropriate for the scientific goals of the study or not adequately justified. For example, if you're doing a study and the population proposed is quite different than the individuals that have the condition, generally there should be some kind of explanation for that. If that's not provided, you may receive an unacceptable rating. And finally, you may have proposed a sample that may be scientifically appropriate but is unrealistic. So, for example, you may be working in an area with a very low percentage of African Americans in the area, and maybe you proposed a study to find 200 African Americans with a rare condition like schizophrenia. You would need to include a plan that explains how you expect to find that group. And in some cases, collaboration and outreach plans may help to work partner with others who can help you to recruit the populations that are needed for your study. Okay, so after your study is funded, now what do you do? Well, after funding, there are a few things that investigators still need to do. For example, they're going to report actual enrollment data in their annual progress reports. And in this case, you're going to provide the table that I showed you earlier, and you'll report the actual number of participants who've participated in your study since the beginning. If you're doing an NIH-defined phase 3 clinical trial, there's an additional requirement to report the results of analyses by sex or gender, race and ethnicity, or the status of those results. It's fine to say these analyses are still in progress if they are, but you do need to address this in your progress report. And if you're doing an applicable NIH-defined phase 3 clinical trial, you'll need to make sure you report results of sex or gender and race and ethnicity in clinicaltrials.gov within 1 year of your primary completion date. This will be submitted along with the rest of your clinicaltrials.gov results. NIH staff are going to check at least annually on your inclusion enrollment progress that you submit during your progress reports. If there are any challenges to enrollment, this should also be addressed in the narrative of your progress report. A new requirement for NIH as a result of the inclusion across the lifespan policy is that investigators submit individual level participant data in progress reports. These data are de-identified, but provide individual level data on sex or gender, race, ethnicity, and age at enrollment for each participant in your study. And this is required for applications that are submitted for due dates January 25th, 2019 or later, and also for those responding to contract solicitations issued after that date and intramural studies initiated after that date. So what you will submit will actually replace the inclusion enrollment report. It looks a lot like a spreadsheet. It's actually a CSV file. And you can see in this example, there are separate columns for race, ethnicity, sex or gender, age, and age unit. Keep in mind that the age that you're providing is the age at enrollment, and the age unit can be in units ranging from minutes to years. There are some resources where you can find out more about the NIH inclusion policies and their implementation at the websites posted here. So in summary, NIH applicants or offerors proposing clinical research must include plans to address inclusion of women, minorities, and individuals across the lifespan. And these plans are evaluated by peer review and determined to be acceptable or unacceptable. After funding, recipients report the progress of enrollment by sex or gender, race, ethnicity, and age at least annually. Now I'd like to ask you a couple of questions. The first question, if peer review finds inclusion plans to be unacceptable, the concerns must be resolved prior to NIH funding, true or false? This is true. The NIH inclusion policies require that any concerns be addressed before funding can be awarded. Next question. If funded, NIH recipients will need to provide data on participant race, ethnicity, sex or gender, and date of birth. True or false? This is false. NIH actually does not collect date of birth for privacy reasons. If you submitted an application January 25th, 2019 or later, however, you will be expected to submit progress reports with data on participant race, ethnicity, and sex or gender, but you'll provide age at enrollment rather than date of birth. I hope you've learned about what you need to submit if you're preparing an application for an NIH grant or a contract proposal. Thank you very much for listening.